Then what? You know, one more this thing, one more correction is there. Kshiram kshire.
Rasamivarase.
Yeah, it's not written. That's why I'm making it line by line. I said one more correction. Rasamivarase.
Rasamivarase.
Toyamevambu madhyaya. Kshiram,
rasam ivarase.
Toyamevambu madhye. Yeah. So this is how they see the world, because we had already got an introduction. How do they see the world? They see the world as non-separate from the cause. And so how does that take place? So here, just like the cause, the effect of gold is nothing but gold. And then, you know, when you take a thimble full of milk and then put it in a big cauldron of milk, you know,
still milk.
Yeah, milk entering milk. Big deal. Okay. Yeah. So kshire kshiram, in the milk, more milk. Okay. And then rasam iva rase. Rasa is mercury. You know. Yeah. Rasam iva rase. So rasa is mercury. So you take some mercury and then pour into it a little more mercury. Will it notice the difference?
No.
So just like that, the clay has to cognitively just, you know, what, resolve into, sorry, the pot has to cognitively likewise resolve into the clay. That is the whole idea. Kshire kshiram rasamivarase. And then you take a bucket of water, you know, and then put it in the ocean. What will happen? Nothing. Okay. Yeah. So, even the salt level will not go down, because your little bucket of water and here is this ocean, you know, what's the point? Nothing, you know. So, the bucket of water is the effect, ocean is the cause, and so in this way, the effect resolves into the cause, like even the ornament, which is nothing but gold, you know, resolving into the gold. And that is how we have to see the ornaments from now on, or any kind of effect from now on. And then just like the, you know, a thimble full of milk in a big vat of milk resolving into it. I mean, in India, they make these halvas outside, you know, because the, you know, otherwise we don't have chimneys and industrial kitchens. Who can afford, you know, other than 5-star hotels? The best chimney is, you know, outdoor cooking with some coal underneath or whatever, and then this big vat in which there is tons of milk, and then it has this big ladle which sometimes two fellows have to, you know, you keep stirring the milk until it becomes solid. For hours together you stir, and then you put sugar, and then you set it, and then cut it, and then give it. It's called barfi, and the Americans say barfi, unfortunately. Barfi, like Murphy, okay? Yeah, not barfi, okay? Yeah. So, and it's a treat to watch, because this huge cauldron, it's called kadhai. Kadhai means what? It's got ears, you know, a shallow, big vat, it's got two ears. And four or five fellows are needed with thick, you know, you need a bed sheet to hold around each ear to bring it down. It's so hot. Iron thing. And then they are making this in a big way, fresh. And then it's, you know, once it's made, it's all gone, you know. Yeah, it's so popular and it's so addictive. And, you know, some people in North India eat it for breakfast, which is not advisable because you get a sugar high. And then, you know, so the point is, let's say this much milk is boiling before it becomes solid, and then you are keeping on, you know, stirring. And then somebody comes and says, can I offer you this thimbleful of milk? Big deal. It's a non-event, correct? Putting a thimbleful of milk, entering a huge cauldron of milk, is it an event or a non-event? It's a non-event. And a bucket full of water, you know, entering the ocean, it's a non-event. It's like sitting in the ocean and crying. Salty tears entering salt water. Go to the ocean, have a good cry, and it's a non-event from the standpoint of the ocean. It's a non-event. Even from the standpoint of the tears, it's a non-event because it has gone to itself, really. That's the idea. The ornament and the gold. When the ornament goes to gold, it has gone to itself. And when the thimble full of milk goes to another vat of milk, it has gone to itself. And then what? The salt, water going into an ocean has gone to itself. And then finally, what other example is there? Toyam means water. Ambu Madhya. Ambu is ocean. Big body of water. One small little miserable bucket of water, you know, has gone. And this is how they see the whole universe. The whole universe they see as resolved in the cause, gone to itself. And starting from where? Starting from their own body, mind, sense complex, gone to itself. And very beautiful. How did they get there? Line number 3, crucial line. Evam sarvam samarasataya
tvam
padam tat padarthe. Together. Nistrai gunye pathi vicharatam. Evam sarvam. So no big deal in this manner. Samarasataya means in the form of that which is non-separate from everything else. Samarasataya in the form of oneness. And what happens in the same manner means something is being shown. So what is that? Tvam padam tatpadarthe. So the tvam pada, the word you or the word I, resolves in Ishvara. Yeah, beautiful. So tvam pada and tatpada are two things in the beginning. Tvam means you. Who is this you? Of course the miserable one. Of course the limited one. Of course the fragmented one. The sad one. The fearful one, the tearful one, this is me, you know. Me identified with the body, this many feet and this many inches tall. Me identified with the mind, you know, angry. And me identified with the prana, hungry. Me identified at the same time with the mind and the prana, hangry. There is such a word. Angry means angry because I am hungry and I didn't know it. Yeah. That means you are associated with prana and mind at the same time. Identified with. And then me identified with the sense organs, seer, hearer, etc. Me identified with what else is there? You know, my possessions, you know, and all these relationships, husband, wife, you know, house, because people are also seen as possessions. That's why one gets possessive, you know. Yeah, my house, my person, my friend. And because you are my friend, you cannot be with other people. Ah, some people think that. I saw you having coffee with that one. So what? You know, there is no, you know, coffee. Having coffee is not like marriage, okay? Yeah. Can have coffee with many people, you know. And no, but I don't like that person. I saw you having coffee with someone I don't like. And that means, so what does that mean? That means that if you are friends with them, you cannot be friends with me. Because I'm disappointed because I thought you were my person. But I like that other person. That person, no, but that person is horrible. You have to take my word. But I don't want to take your word. I happen to get along well with the other person. Okay, then you will have to say goodbye to me. This is how it is, you know. So, identified with people, identified with possessions, including pets, my dog, my cat, you know. And that kind of a, you know, thing. It's all mine, mine, mine. And then, you know, I went one time to the house of one lady in New York, apartment in New York, who owned a big parrot. And, you know, and this parrot could talk and would repeat everything. So, somebody was coming in and they did not close the door and there was a draft, "It's cold, close the door, close the door," she would say. And nobody knew how much she understood, you know, till she flew away. You know, the lady had gone out for some time, for a whole wedding or something. She was gone for a day and a half. And then she came back for her grandchild's wedding. And she came back and the house sitter left the door open. And even though the parrot had a little bit of wings clipped or something, sad, but true, it flew away. But it couldn't go far. She was on top of a tree, and you know, and they tried to, you know, give her the best of the things she liked, and got, and she liked Indian food, so they got her some from Indian food and tried to cajole her. She would not come back inside, so the house sitter was panicking, but thankfully the parrot was in sight. It was just outside the tree, and I was told that the lady came and cajoled the parrot to come in, you know. "Here, look, Mama is back. Come in." And the parrot said, "But I'm free." It understood.
It's
It may as well have said, "Nistray gunye pati vichara." Go, Nishayda. You know, "I love you, but I'm free." It said that 3-4 times. And the woman wept. She said, "You know, I think, you know, but I don't know if you will survive." And parrot didn't understand survive. "What survive?" And the woman said, "Okay, grandma said, better you remain there itself." And it would come to the windowsill and eat something. I don't know what happened to it. It would, then the wings, of course, grow back. So, you know, it's like hair. So I don't know what happened to it, but it would come and she would keep some bread on the windowsill, and she would come and eat it and all that. So like this. So you see, this is something such a, you know, such a wonder that you think it is your parrot. Parrot doesn't think it is you. Yeah. Parrot is just looking for a way, even though it is so domesticated. And it is saying, "Take off your hat, take off your coat," all this it would say. You know, I had met it before it ran away, flew away. "Take off your hat, take off your coat." And then one person said, "You know, but I don't have a hat." "Oh, bad manners." It would say all these things.
Wow.
A very talkative parrot, and all kinds of things it would say. And then, you know, and then if she burnt something in the kitchen, "Uh-oh, you forgot to turn off the stove." It would say all kinds of things. And so this parrot, you know, which had become a householder, so to speak, it was her companion. She had been widowed early, and it was who she talked to and who she related to, you know, right in Manhattan, you know, in a small little apartment. And it had taken care of everything, and it knew stove, it knew hat, coat, door, close the door, you know, all these things. But then as soon as it went and sat on the tree, it said, "Okay, I'm free. You may think I'm your parrot. I ain't belonging to no one." Yeah. That was there. So this way of possessing, and this is how one identifies oneself. And the more one identifies oneself as the owner of this or the owner of that, the more grief there is. Like, for example, this lady took a long time to get over the fact that the parrot is no longer hers. Means again, inside, outside. In the house, it's mine. Out of the house, it's not mine. You see, this is how the whole thing is. And so that is what is the recipe for sorrow. And so this is what constitutes, we are describing now, Tvampada. So this is Tvampada, the finitude of these limited identifications, being in touch with all these identifications that are useless and limited, because the more you identify as mother of so-and-so, child of so-and-so, son of so-and-so, daughter of so-and-so, friend of so-and-so, pet of so-and-so, you know, all these things, then, you know, you're doing yourself, you're doing Satchidananda yourself a disservice. So that freedom is that inner freedom, and that inner freedom comes from identifying with what is called the word Tat. Tat means Brahman, Tat means cause, Tat means Ishvara, Tat is Satchidananda, the word Tat. Tvam is the miserable I that is boxed up in all these identities, starting with this body and up to the, you know, one's ideologies, beliefs, possessions, etc. The whole range. This is what is called Tvampada. Very sad, because the more identities one has, and we have seen this in detail, the more identities that one has, the harder it is to what? Be Satchidananda, to identify as Satchidananda, which one already is. In fact, that's the only identity one has. And so the Tvampada is now entering the Tatpada, awareness-wise. So the I notion is now entering Satchidananda. Oh, that must be a terrible event. Horrible. I'm losing my identity. I'm losing my one, you know, my whatever, my possessions. I'm losing that individuality. I'm losing that uniqueness. I'm losing that myness and myself. I'm losing into the whole. And therefore, I don't want this knowledge. Or I'm afraid of this knowledge. No, no, no. Don't worry. It's a non-event. Like what? Like the thimbleful of milk entering into milk. Like a bucket full of water entering, being cast into the ocean. Like mercury being filled up with mercury. Is that an event? No. Does it come in the newspaper? A thimble full of milk today entered a big vat of milk. It is not newsworthy. It's a non-event. Gold became gold. Hello, you know. Are you stupid or what? What is there to report in this? If some reporter started to report all this, he or she would lose the job. Yeah. This is not, you know, this is nothing to report. This is not news. A bucket full of water entered the ocean just off the Oregon coast. Yeah, this is... Isme kya hai? What is there to report in this? This is a non-event. And even though all these conniptions the jiva has about quote-unquote becoming one with Satchidananda, OMG, how is this going to happen? What do I have to give up? I have given up so many things. I'm just crying. I just said, do I have to give up me and mine and even this body, not my body. And it's a non-event. Yes, it's a non-event. What are you crying about? It's a non-event. Just like taking out the garbage is a non-event. You don't have to call the reporters and say, the world's biggest garbage is going out now. Please come and write about it. So the person calls the reporters and they, you know, in the dark, you take out the garbage and they are flash, flash, yes. So how, what is your relationship to the garbage right now? You know, how did you feel about it before? And then how difficult is this to throw away? It's a non-event. Nobody cries when giving up the garbage. And so here what you are giving up in terms of the finite identity is just garbage. Yes. Not even recycling. It is garbage. It has to be thrown away. It's a non-event. Every week you do it effortlessly. You don't cry. People don't have a funeral for the garbage. Oh, poor thing. You know? So quickly it had to go, you know. Let's just sit and sort of say a silent prayer over this garbage. May you have sadgati. May you be fine in the afterlife, you know. May you be born again as my garbage. No. No such thing. You're happy to get rid of it. Otherwise it is stinking. Otherwise it is just causing, you know, a lot of problems. Unsanitary. So small things which circle it will soon be born from it. So you don't want all that. So week after week, all the things that, you know, all the things that have been consumed and the residue of that consumption, you know, is just put out of the house. And thankfully we have a system for that, a very sophisticated system where the arms of the truck come and take that whole thing, very nice to watch, you know, and then put it back. Yeah, swaha. It's like a yagya. It's like a yagya. You don't cry when you give up the garbage. You're happy. Same thing, this tvam pada is filled with garbage. It has to be, you know, all this has to, you know, be gone. I am as good as this. Gone, it's garbage. Because it's not letting you, you know, not letting you be yourself. It's coming in the way of, you know, hygienic living as Satchidananda. It's coming in the way of being healthy. It's coming in the way of just, you know, being in the present. All the things of the past just, you know, piling. And then, you know, this garbage. And the garbage has to be given up, given away. And it is done so effortlessly. And so the garbage joins other garbage, non-news, effortlessly. And once the garbage joins that big, what is it called? Dumpster. Yeah, I like that word. Dumpster, because you just dump. And then, if you wanted to, then you say, ayayo, there was a gold ring there. Then you go to the dumpster. And you know, same looking bags, correct? How are you going to say which one? And then it's so unsanitary, you say, Om Namah Shivaya to the gold ring. Let somebody find it, keep it, doesn't matter. So you see, once the garbage, the point is this, once your garbage has joined the general janata garbage, then, you know, it's just garbage. No longer is the word mine, you know, you can never use the preposition, the pronoun mine, attached to the garbage, correct? Because it's the general garbage. So too, like this, everybody giving up the meanness and the myness, you know, is just like the general, you know, what is that? The general garbage in the dustbin of samsara, it is to be put, and that is how effortlessly one, you know, regains oneself as Satchidananda. Because imagine the whole house is full of garbage. You don't know where Satchidananda is hiding. You know, like I was talking in San Jose recently, and I was talking of this show. What is the name of that show? Some show is there.
Hoarders.
Correct. And so I was talking about the show. And then I said, these people, you know, they were in dire distress. They called the TV crew because they couldn't find their middle child. And in all the garbage.
Oh my God.
I made that up. Yeah. So, actually, they couldn't find their cat. But, you know, but it's almost the same. You know, they loved their cat so much. It was behind a mattress, poor thing shivering. And, you know, might as well have been their middle child. And so they couldn't find their, you know, I was just joking, they couldn't find their middle child, you know, because of the garbage. So replace the word middle child with Satchidananda, you know, something very dear to you, something you want to be one with. And this is missing. Is it really missing? No, it's not missing. It is overlaid with all these limited identifications which need to go. And then one's identification with oneself as Satchidananda, after the garbage, you have kissed the garbage goodbye, then what happens? then that quote unquote merging is effortless, because it's not really a merging. There are no two things. That is the emergent knowledge, is that there is no merging. The merging is like salt water into the sea, is like milk into milk, is like mercury with mercury, ornament into gold. There is no merging really to speak. You know, really speaking, where is the merging? You know, there is only emerging understanding that there is no merging. No merging whatsoever. What is there to merge? See, when there are only two separate things, you merge them together. There is no blending, there is no merging. There is just oneness, and it's a non-event. So, just like the Tvampada slips into the Tatpada, your understanding of the I slips into Satchidananda. When once this garbage has been thrown, the garbage of this, you know, finite identification. Okay. Nistrai gunye pathi vicharata.
Nistrai gunye pathi vicharata.
Together ko vidhikko nishedha. It's of no use whatever I say. So, let's do it together so we get into the habit. Nistrai gunye pathi vicharata. Ko vidhi ko nishedha. Yeah. So ko vidhi hi, for such persons, you know, where there's only one Satchidananda and they are part of that Satchidananda, not part, they are that Satchidananda. They have quote unquote become one with that Satchidananda. What rules, you know, what injunctions, what prohibitions. We can stop here, you know. No, where is that? What verse is that? Yeah, let us know. We can go further. Yeah. Okay. So, it's only three. Okay. I thought it was five. That's why I happily said we can stop here. Okay, yeah. Yasmin Vishwam.
Yasmin Vishwam.
Sakala Bhuvanam.
Sakala Bhuvanam.
Samarasyaika Bhutam.
Samarasyaika Bhutam.
Urvityapo.
Urvityapo.
Analamanilam. Analamanilakham. Urvityapo nalamanilakham.
Urvityapo nalamanilakham.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a tongue twister. Nalamanilakham.
Nalamanilakham.
Urvityapo nalamanilakham.
Urvityapo nalamanilakham.
Jivamevam kramena.
Jivamevam kramena.
Yet it should be kshira, not kshara. Okay. Oh, maybe kshara. Wait. 1 minute. Let me just see. Oh, it doesn't even translate. Yeah, kshara. Yeah. Yat ksharabdhau. Samarasataya.
Samarasataya.
Saindhavaikatva bhutam.
Saindhavaikatva bhutam.
Together. Nistrai gunye pathi vicharatam. Ko vidhi ko nishedha. Yasmin vishvam. In which Atma, in which Self, in whom the whole universe, Vishwam, universe. And what has the Vishwam done? Sakala Bhuvanam. Sakala Bhuvanam means that, you know, that that whole, all the three worlds, in which the whole universe, along with all the three worlds, Samarasya Ekabhutam, has gained oneness. In whom? So the person now is, now we are expanding from what? One's body and, you know, from this universe to any other parallel universes that may exist. All other lokas, not just this bhuloka, but other lokas. Three lokas, bhuhu, bhuvaha, suvaha, vise, or seven lokas, seven up, seven down, 14 lokas, all of them. In whom all those lokas have resolved. Where is heaven? Right here. You know, where is something else? Right here. There is no question of where, because the question of where is, you know, contingent upon space. And that space is where? You know, everywhere. And that I is everywhere. The I, the observer of space, is everywhere, is everything. So now, this is not just on the level of one's family members and possessions. Now we are on the broad cosmic collective level of the five elements. So for whom all the worlds are one and all the worlds are non-separate from themselves. And then Urvi. Urvi means the earth. Apaha. Apaha means water. And then Analaha. Analaha means what? Analaha. Fire. Anilaha. Wind. Yeah. Fire, air, water, earth, and Kham. What is Kham? Space. Yeah. That is good, because if all four are taken, then what is left is space. Very nice. Kham is space. So for whom Urvi, you know, iti apaha Urvi tyapo, Urvi tyapo nala nila anila and kham, all of them, these five elements, and tatha jivam and the jivas, evam kramena. Kramena means in that order. So see how this order is from the, you know, the grossest, we go to the subtlest. Earth, gross, because it can be objectified with all five sense organs. You can touch it, you can see it, you can smell it. That is, the smell of clay is the smell of earth. And you can, what else can you do with it, you know? You can hear it, you can hear the earth moving, shifting, all these things. So it is available to all the senses. Then afterwards, apaha. Water is available to how many senses?
Four.
Because it has no smell. Okay? And don't say, what about ditch water? That is aropita. Yeah. Ditch water is super, that ditchiness is superimposed upon that water. Right? Yeah. Don't say, what about sewage? It's a superimposition upon water. Okay? So then you have, after water, what comes? Analaha, fire. Little more subtle, because it's only with three sense organs it can be objectified. What are the sense organs that objectify fire?
Sight.
First thing. Sound, because it crackles and makes that sound. And then?
Touch,
which you don't want. No touch. But, you know, potentially with touch you can objectify. That's why one moves away from the fire. Sit far away from the Homa today. And, you know, yeah, be careful. Then, so then after that, little more subtle is air. Because with only two sense organs you can objectify air. What are the two sense organs?
Touch.
Because if you dip your hand in water and go like this, you feel it. And then, or you run like that, you feel the air. And then?
Hearing.
Yeah. And then finally you go to space. Yeah. Only one sense organs you can identify space. What is that sense organ?
Hearing.
Because you say, I could hear the pin drop. Sound and space are linked. So therefore, now you have what? All these, you know, elements, kramena, you know, in the order from gross to subtle. There is a beautiful order. It's all dependent on you, the cognizer, on that Satchidananda Atma that is able to cognize. It is amazing. So that which is all dependent upon you, this is what it is there. And then, you know, jivaha, so the individual, jiva is individual. So, and then they all are one with Bhagavan, one with Brahman, and that oneness is there. And then here it says kramena, because we are talking about, the that which is cognized, which resolves into the cognizer, jiva, and the cognizer resolves into Brahman. That is how. That's why that is the kramena. It's not like first earth becomes one with Brahman, then fire, then water. No. Don't take it like that. That kramena, order, is what all these are cognized, and the one who is a cognizer, jiva, recognizes that this is non-separate from the cognizer, which is myself, and that I is Brahman alone. Okay? So that is the kramena resolution. And then what? How? Yatha, yat means just as, you know, it should be yatha, but because the meter doesn't allow it, yat is short for yatha, just as. Ksharabdhav, you know, in the salty water, which is, what is salty water?
Ocean.
Ocean, yeah. In the ocean, samarasataya, when in the spirit of oneness, saindhava ekatva bhutam, saindhava ekatva bhutam. A salt doll is introduced into the ocean. What happens to the salt doll?
Dissolves.
Yeah. It becomes no doll, only salt. Yeah, only water. Correct? Only ocean. So the salt doll, this is a very, you know, interesting metaphor. I don't know who would make salt dolls, first of all. And then who would go and put them in the ocean. But I think there was an ancient ritual, you know. And like especially in the unfortunate event of the death of a child, you know. So they would make an effigy of the child in salt to console themselves and say Bhagavan has taken, it has become one with Bhagavan. So as a ritual, they would offer it to the ocean and watch it melt and say that, okay, it has become one with the ocean. It was a kind of a, you know, letting go of the grief thing. So I think it is referring to some such ritual where the salt is, you know, something made of salt is offered to the ocean. And sometimes they, you know, they have a, in Africa, they have a prayer for the ocean, and they have lot of salt balls that are offered as an offering, laddus made of salt. I thought that was interesting. So, like this, you know, they have that ritual. So maybe, you know, and this has become a catchphrase for the Vedantin. All the Vedantins love this salt doll entering the ocean, and it is losing what? The dollness, but gaining the whole oceanic limitlessness. And so that is what, so it's only losing name and form, and so like that. So just like Kshaarabdhav in the already salty water, what happens? A salt doll, Saindhava, made of salt, that which is made of salt, here salt doll is introduced and it becomes one with the ocean. Similarly, these people, istray gunne pathi vicharatam, for such people who have become one, you know, in whom all the worlds reside, in whom all the five elements reside, in whom everything resides, all of them are what? You know, one with everything. And for such people, what rules are you going to ask them to follow? And what, you know, prohibitions is they are they subject to? So that is the whole idea. This is verse number 4. Tomorrow evening there is no class. Sunday, take off. But really not off, because we are having Bodhisara in the morning. What? 9:30 to 12. Today evening also no class, because we have made up for it. And then so the next class will be on Monday. Don't forget the first 4 verses. Okay? Alright. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om. I said I would take questions. And so I already took one, that's nice. And then so if there is anything else you can tell. If there is anything that wasn't understood, or if there is one more question, you can do that. Any questions here? No? Yeah. Oh, great, tell me, yeah.
So this kind of gold resolving into gold.
Yeah.
It's sometimes confusing for me to think that there's this cause that's creating this effect, but the effect isn't creating the cause, but it's still gold.
And yes. Okay, just like the pot, don't forget about gold. You know, that was what they used here.
Okay.
So the clay creates the pot, correct? Yeah. So the clay is manifest as the pot. And then the pot is not clay. Because the clay is free enough to be a lump on the roadside, it is free enough to be a lid. At the same time, it upkeeps and upholds everything without being any one thing. It upholds the world of earthenware without being a single pot. Yeah, it is lends its sustenance to everything without being any one thing. That is what has to be understood. Yeah. Okay, see you all tomorrow for Bodhisara. Yeah, parrot story you liked? Yeah, very good. Yeah, I'm coming to the Gurukulam. Next week I'll be there. Come and see me if you can. That will be nice to see you. So, tomorrow what time? Eastern time, Bodhisara? 12:30. Yeah, 12:30. Yeah, 12:30 Eastern time, and I don't know what is India time. If it is too late, not too late. It is 10 o'clock India time. 10 to 12 it will be for you. If it is too late, you can catch up on live stream. Okay.